The spectacular Naomi Yamaguchi. Thank you. Thank you so much for an incredibly gorgeous performance. I think you have a new fan club. It's nationally based. From across the country, we'll be watching your career, cheering you on, and we look forward to the day we can say we knew her when. It was back in 2016 in Grand Rapids. Thank you so much. And please help me thank Jane for her incredible presentation. Already we can see the Creativity Connects report is illuminating, and I know we all look forward to a deep dive and to having that inform work going forward. You know, if you've heard Jane before, and many of you have, you know that she often refers to the bright spots, and you should know you're our bright spot. In Aaron Dworkin, we have a MacArthur Fellow, President Obama's first appointment to the National Council on the Arts, and Dean of the University of Michigan School of Music, Theater, and Dance. He is an accomplished multimedia performing artist, author, social entrepreneur, artist, citizen, and educator. You can hear, Aaron has many gifts, and he shares his gifts with society in countless ways, and notably through his work at the Sphinx Organization and the Dworkin Foundation. Especially close to all our hearts, Aaron is a member of the Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs, where he invests his talents to strengthen our sister agency in service to the people of Michigan. Please help me welcome to the stage Aaron Dworkin.
Thanks so much, Pam. And Naomi, we need to have a discussion about the University of Michigan. That was tremendous, really tremendous. Hang on 1 second. I think they will bring up. There we go. I wanted to start with a little clip of another Michigander, Melissa White. And I wanted to share it with you to begin with because she was a winner of the early Sphinx competitions. She was a participant and a finalist in the inaugural Sphinx competition back in 98. She then went on to become a founding member of the Harlem Quartet. But early on here in Michigan, she was a member of the Detroit Civic Orchestra. In many ways, she was discovered very early on by the James Tatum Foundation. She went on to be also a soloist early on with the Lansing Symphony, as well as the Detroit Symphony, all organizations supported by the Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs. And I thought it would be important to share that type of direct impact that's happening, if we could show that video. This brings up actually one of my favorite quotes that I wanted to start with, which is that the deepest defeat suffered by human beings is constituted by the difference between what one was capable of becoming and what one has, in fact, become. Ashley Montague is one of the great humanist intellectuals of our time, whose contributions include the Elephant Man, women's movement with the natural superiority of women. But when I hear his words, I think to myself, what shall I think about and consider of Melissa, whose accomplishments not only meet expectations, but exceed what anyone might have thought she was possible, that was possible for her to do. She was just most recently last month in Europe performing. And the reality is that our state arts agencies often play that pivotal role early on with artists like Melissa. I wanted to share some of the work that we're doing at Michigan, but to kind of describe that, the work that I think we all do as artists is really fused by our personal lives. So I wanted to give you a quick background on myself, so I figured I'd start at the beginning, given that I've only got 20 minutes. But I was born, actually just celebrated my birthday on September 11th in upstate New York, but I was immediately given up for adoption. I was adopted by a white Jewish couple who were from Chicago, who were neuroscientists. And they actually already had a birth child, my older brother, who is now a cellular biologist and biogeneticist at Columbia. So in many ways, I was literally the black sheep of the family, not just color. But yeah, I was the artist, I was spontaneous, I was, you know, a little more passionate about things, and they were very methodical and logical. Hopefully along the ways I've combined all of these facets. Fast forward 31 years, I was reunited with my birth parents. My birth father, who's Black Jehovah's Witness, my birth mother, who's white Irish Catholic. And not only did they end up getting back together, they had another child, who they did raise, my full sister, who I was able to encourage to come to the University of Michigan, my alma mater, and we became very, very close, and she now practices law and works with legal aid in New York City. So basically, in the end, I'm kind of a black, white, Jewish, Irish, Catholic, Jehovah's Witness who plays the violin, used to have a big afro. That's kind of me. So in terms of my development, my adoptive mother was an amateur violinist, so that's how I began to play. I began playing early on in New York. I was very lucky to have phenomenal teaching. My adoptive dad, you're wondering these photos, my adoptive dad was an amateur photographer. And so actually he ended up having an exhibit at Rockefeller, which is where they worked, and actually most recently had an exhibit in Sweden. And so I was very lucky early on to have a phenomenal teaching, Vladimir Grafman, who really brought the Russian school over, was my first teacher, so I was very lucky. He taught the likes of Joseph Gingold, who taught Joshua Bell, and many of our other great soloists today. And one of the other things is that I had the opportunity to play chamber music beginning at a very early age. And that opportunity to collaborate with other musicians was incredibly profound in my life. So initially New York till I was 10 years old, 92nd Street Y, and then when I was 10, my parents moved to Hershey, Pennsylvania, which is quite an extraordinary experience for me. At the time, there was one black family in my school district. You imagine, big afro playing by, it was tough, last name Dworkin. No one really knew what to make of me. So, and it was my violin that really was the way that I could express at certain times when I did feel very isolated. My violin is the greatest constant in my life. I was very, very lucky, and my introduction to the state of Michigan came my junior and senior year of high school when I got to go to the Interlochen Arts Academy for my junior and senior year of high school. Then I started out at Penn State for 2 years, Concertmaster Penn State Philharmonic, then had 4 years actually off where I got a lot of nonprofit, for-profit experience, and then finished working on my degrees, undergraduate and graduate degrees, at the University of Michigan. Here I'm with my teacher, Steve Shipps. And it was while I was at Michigan that I had a series of extraordinary experiences where I had the opportunity to explore different things, to explore interdisciplinary work, as the chairman was referencing, which is so critical, I think, in our field. I had the opportunity to work with dancers. You can see in the center picture there, I worked with choreographers and formed a quartet. We assigned a dancer to each of them, did performances. I did recitals on electric violin. I worked with jazz artists. In the lower left, you can see kind of visuals. I would select certain works that were based on works of visual art, and I would project those on the screen behind me. And in the end, basically, Michigan empowered me to be able to be relevant to my art form and to my community. And I'm going to mention this word relevance a few more times. And in addition to that, I was able to have this kind of idea because as I was kind of at Michigan, I started thinking about why was I often the only person who looked like me on stage or in the audience, and started thinking about these issues of inclusion and diversity. And that led me to really this initial idea of what if there was a competition for students like me. We could come together, play works by composers of color, and if we just did that, the world would be a little bit of a better place and we'd solve this whole problem in classical music like that. Began to realize it was a little more complex of a problem, and so Sphinx, of course, developed into a host of different aspects to really try to be able to develop this work. But the reason why I wanted to share this is not to kind of talk about these various programs that Sphinx has done over now, it will be celebrating its 20th year this next year, but because very early on, there were key people and institutions that played a role. And I wanted to just mention a couple of them because I think they're very relevant here. And Wayne Brown, who spent many years, of course, as we all know, leading music and opera at the NEA and is now, of course, at our wonderful opera theater here in Michigan. When I was just a student and founding it, and I had, of course, no idea what I'm doing, he was like, well, have you talked with the Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs? I'm like, what is that? What do I do? And he just began to share with me a lot of these things to do to actually try and build an institution, to take what otherwise is a dream, and unrealized dreams, unfortunately, don't impact anyone. You have to be able to realize them. And it takes these types of mentors and role models. John Bracey, Betty Boone. I had no idea what I was doing. How do I apply for a grant? What on earth do I do? How do I connect with others? How do I collaborate? How do I build a budget? Profound impact. And of course, John is just leading our extraordinary efforts here at Michigan. And that led to Sphinx's first MCACA grant in its early years, which was profound. And not only because of the direct support, but because then the next words out of your mouth always are, please join the Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs. It brings legitimacy, it brings a sense of rigor, and it brings a level of seriousness to the enterprise that you're working on. That, of course, led after 3 years of programming to our NEA grant, and which was transformative, of course, and profound. And for so many organizations, that pivotal point where you really transcend from your early years into an ongoing, sustainable enterprise that can impact communities. And then I didn't want to, just as I was thinking about this and putting, that I was able to serve on an MCACA panel. I was so honored when I was first asked to be able to participate in that way, because it wasn't just service. I learned so much by serving on the MCACA panels over the years, and seeing what my peers and our fellow organizations were doing, and understanding how to kind of look and adjudicate and to understand in a curatorial way the work that we all do. And literally from that first year I had that opportunity, it transformed my own way of looking at the work that Sphinx was doing in the early years. And the same was the case for serving on NEA panels. And this ability to participate in the work that all of you lead on a daily basis. And then, of course, being able to go on and serve and learn, as I do now, on both the National Council as well as our State Council, have truly, truly been profound for me. And it's because of all of these experiences that Sphinx was able to do the work that it has been able to do over the years and really become the most relevant national arts organization in its sphere, really focusing on transforming lives through the power of diversity in the arts. And so after 19 years, my wonderful alma mater invited me to come back and join the School of Music, Theater, and Dance. And this was interesting for me because I very much believe in the adage, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I was being invited to come back to this extraordinary institution that was already excellent and awesome. So I really began thinking about what was it that I could bring what added value to help it in its trajectory and to be a good steward, but to also help its evolution. We're a phenomenal institution, almost 180 faculty, almost 100 staff, great student to faculty ratio, extraordinary accomplishments of all of our alums. Speaking of musical theater earlier, we were just kind of re-announced as the number one musical theater department in the country, and we're always part of the top five performing arts institutions, a host of different things. And so as I began to have these conversations in a listening tour, I love this quote from Susan Scott that I wanted to share, who developed FEARS. And she says, "Our work, our relationships, and our lives succeed or fail one conversation at a time. And while no single conversation is guaranteed to change the trajectory of your life, any single conversation can. So speak and listen as if this is the most important conversation you will ever have with this person, because it could be. And participate as if it matters, because it does." And throughout my life, I have strived, not always successfully, but I've strived to have that approach. And I think about some of those early conversations I had with John Bracey, with Wayne Brown, with others, that literally changed the trajectory of my life. And so I was trying to bring that approach to my work at the University of Michigan. And that led to the idea that we really needed to understand what unified us. We have 16 different departments, such a breadth of incredible disciplines that are tackled at the school. What unifies us? What drives us all together when we think about the work that we're doing? And a vision as opposed to a mission, which can be very, sometimes, bullet pointed, complex. It often sits in filing cabinets at many organizations and institutions. But the vision is lived through, it's breathed every day through all of the constituents of an institution. And at Michigan, it's very simple, that we will become the most relevant school of the performing arts in the world. That's it. This is how we operate, this is what we are doing. And as we strive for this, one of the things, my favorite quotes again from Lyndon Johnson in terms of signing into law, the NEA said, "Art is the nation's most precious heritage, for it is in our works of art that we reveal to ourselves and to others the inner vision which guides us as a nation. And where there is no vision, the people perish." And I believe that is the case for organizations. Where there is no vision, the work that we do can so easily vanish. And so what do we mean when we say relevance? We really mean the dictionary definition, having a significant demonstrable bearing on the matter at hand. So really, there's two ways in which we realize this relevance. Number one, we must educate and train our students to be relevant, to be able, by the time they graduate, to have a significant demonstrable bearing on their specific field of study. And secondarily, it is our responsibility to make sure we empower our faculty and our students to have these fields of study that we train in be relevant to society. And if we do that, then we will have successful grads. They'll go out, have phenomenal careers, earn lots of money, and come back to the school and be wonderful donors. So one additional part of this is that as we carry out this work, there are kind of four pillars that we really center on, and they are innovation, inclusion, excellence, and resources. These are the ways in which we really embody how we do our work on a day-to-day basis. And they're all really self-explanatory, but one of the key things I just wanted to mention is this famous quote from Chimamanda Adichie, a Nigerian author, is just incredible, and she writes about this danger. And she talks about it, that the danger of a single story is not that it is untrue, but that it is incomplete. And the reality is that when we think about inclusion in the performing arts, the stories we weave about our nation are incomplete. And I think now more than ever, it is imperative, and we have a responsibility to make sure that these stories we weave reflect all corners of our society and of our nation. And so I wanted to give just a quick snapshot of the kind of foundation and private sector giving as it relates to inclusion. And I'm just going to share this slide really quickly. And this comes out of the NCRP, the National Committee for Responsive Philanthropy, because I just wanted to paint this quick picture before I close and also share why the work that all of you do is so critically important. So nationally, total foundation giving is about $22 billion a year. Arts and culture grants are about $2.3 billion each year. the grants that benefit underserved communities is only about $200 million of that $2.3 billion. And the interesting thing is that focused arts funders that commit more than 25% of their grant making to the arts, give less towards benefiting and impacting underserved communities. It's only about $100 million. So in other words, less than their peers in the foundation field who do not focus on the arts, they give less and focus less on underserved communities. And also thinking about the distribution in terms of the size of organizations, which is so critical. And when you think about the support, for example, in the early years for Sphinx. Of all arts organizations, all 100,000 across the country, about 2% have budgets greater than $5 million. That 2% of our arts organizations receive 55% of all foundation funding. And as a matter of fact, and that's kind of surprising, but it's a little bit expected. If we just take the top 50 organizations out of the 100,000, so in other words, 0.0005% of all arts organizations, those 50 organizations receive half of all foundation funding for arts and culture. And so one of the results that Holly Sitford, who generated this study, says is this pronounced imbalance restricts the expressive life of millions of people, thus constraining our creativity as a nation. The asymmetry disadvantages all of us by restricting the types of cultural expressions we experience. And that makes me think directly to Chimamanda Adichie's quote about the stories and the danger of the single stories and whether what we are doing is still incomplete. And I think more importantly that it's because of this that the role of states' arts agencies is even more important. When I think about the impact of access, openness, the experience of review panels, innovation, major national foundations began to support Sphinx after the Michigan Council for Arts and Cultural Affairs supported Sphinx. Who is at the forefront of discovering the new innovations, understanding our arts communities at a local or regional level, leaders, who's understanding the landscape at the national level? It is each and every one of you that do this work every day in our communities. It has a profound effect, and because this is our overall national reality that our arts organizations face, the role that you play is even more pivotal. And the reality is that Sphinx would not exist, and I would not be leading our efforts at the School of Music, Theater, and Dance at the University of Michigan, if not for the work that you do. So I wanted to close with one last kind of comparative slide, just to give you a sense. And as you know, kind of our the appropriation approximately $146 million at the NEA, but I wanted to try and find a comparative just analysis, just to give a sense in terms of public funding that relates to this idea of relevance, because there are always calls or challenges or issues about public funding for the arts and appropriations for the NEA. And so I thought I would just pull out the military bands budget. Now keep in mind, not including the actual line item in terms of personnel, so just the budget for military bands, and keep in mind the breadth of the NEA and all of that. So just specifically for military bands annually, it's over $350 million. And of course, we don't hear calls or challenges to those types of appropriations. And I submit to you, it's because there is not a doubt about the relevance. When we think about the role of music in our armed forces, going back to Civil War, any of our wars, when the commander-in-chief walks into a room, music plays. Music plays a profound role in and within and surrounding the military. And so I believe that the responsibility is upon our field to be able to make sure that we make the work that we do relevant. And when we think about it at the School of Music, Theater, and Dance, it is about training and educating our students to be relevant to these fields of discipline that we feel so strongly about, and then making sure that it's our responsibility to empower our faculty and our students to have these fields that we are so deeply invested in be relevant to society. And I think we are on a trajectory, and we have to continue, and we will do that all together. I love quotes. My second to last quote here, Larry Page, another one of our alumnus from the University of Michigan. Google, of course, now Alphabet. And one of the things I keep sharing with my faculty as we approach change is I share with them that we've long believed that over time companies tend to get comfortable doing the same thing, just making incremental changes. But you need to be a bit uncomfortable to stay relevant. And so each and every day at Michigan, we think about and we strive to get a little more comfortable with being uncomfortable as we brace into new work in entrepreneurialism, in interdisciplinary work. And so just to close, I wanted to share probably one of my favorite quotes. Years ago, I had the opportunity to be down in Atlanta for a philanthropy conference in the Black community, and one of the Sphinx alums was performing before Coretta Scott King. It was incredibly powerful, and she came up to me afterwards talking about the importance of music and how it was important to their movement and to her and Martin. You know, her and Martin met at the New England Conservatory of Music, where she was studying. Music was a pivotal role in their lives, and it just makes me think about his famous quote, "The change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but comes through continuous struggle." History will have to record that the greatest tragedy about this period was not the strident clamor of the bad people, but the appalling silence of the good people. Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. And I thank all of you for this incredible work that you do each and every day that has utterly changed the trajectory of my life and that matters so much to our society and to our nation. Thank you so much.